Good day, fellow investors. Welcome to the stock market news with a long-term fundamental twist. Today's topics are, of course, Apple reaching 1 billion, then how there is a difference between the S&P 500, what's going on in the United States, China and Europe at the moment in the economy. We'll discuss what's going on with the economy in the US, and then we'll discuss what's going on with the economy in Europe. There are a lot of divergences, and that's something very interesting to look at from an investing perspective. So let's start to talk about Apple and what is there that is a long-term fundamental lesson for investors. So Apple, I wrote an article, I think, April 2016, saying that Apple is a good long-term buy. And I was even long Apple at around 100. So now Apple is more than doubled, has more than doubled from the low 90 that it hit, I think it was somewhere in 2016. What happened there? How come that such a big company goes from 90 to 210 in just 2.5 years? So the key here is that Apple in 2016 was valued as a cash cow, as a declining stock, because everybody was scared about declining iPhone sales. Today, things haven't changed that much, but Apple is valued differently and is valued as a growth stock. Today, earnings are $11.6 per share. 2015, that was the result that was used to calculate 2016, earnings were 9 point something. So there is just a 20% difference in earnings per share. However, then the valuation was 10, and that was a big buy for me because of the Apple cycle, iPhone cycle. And now the valuation is already 18 point something and earnings have increased and you have a double in the stock price. And that's the investing lesson. If you can find those stocks that are misunderstood by the market by far, because the downside for the iPhone from the ecosystem that Apple was building then was not that big. And it was just a temporary. Always remember, Wall Street looks 1, 2, 3 quarters max ahead. So then we had Wall Street very negative about the subsequent quarters, and you have seen Apple stock drop to 90. Now we have Wall Street very positive on revenue from services, positive on iPhones, stable outlooks, and now everybody is bullish, and Apple is raising that valuation going from 10 now to 18. And if Apple gets a normal market valuation, then we'll see Apple at 300, maybe even 400, because peers have similar valuations. Google has a price earnings ratio of 53, Microsoft has a price earnings ratio of 50, Procter & Gamble, compare that to Apple, has a price earnings ratio of 22. So there is plenty more upside for Apple if it gets valued as a normal market stock. But that really shows how market perception has a huge impact on the stock, even if the fundamentals are still there. 2016, Apple was a cash producing machine. Now Apple is a cash producing machine. The stock has doubled. So same things, just a little bit, a little small shift in perception and the stock explodes. So you have to buy when Wall Street is negative about something and then hold until the trend, if you see that the trend can shift, that the sentiment can go from negative to positive, especially on such stocks that have stable production, stable outlooks, they are strong cash producing machines. Will I invest in Apple? 18 price earnings ratio. If I look at the growth, revenue growth over the last few years hasn't been that strong, so they will be a slow grower. Somehow I feel, especially if there comes a recession that hits iPhone sales still, then it is, let's say, the risk reward isn't that attractive for me. I prefer better risk rewards. However, I'm saying Apple can go to 300, 400 in, let's say, a crazy environment where things just continue as they are and people start comparing it to Microsoft, Google, etc. On the S&P 500 index, everything well, especially Apple, gave it a boost this week, and the 5 days change is again very, very positive. However, trade wars, Trump announcing more constrictions, really, those trade wars hit again the Shanghai Composite Index. So in China, stocks went down 4.63%. It seems like the market doesn't see A connection between China and US stocks. In the US, things all well, everything goes up. In China, everybody's scared that those stocks will do badly in the trade war. And that's something very interesting. What's the difference between China and the United States when it comes to the stock market? On one hand, everybody is positive in the United States. We have good economic data. We'll now check what the Fed has to say. And on the other hand, in China, people are looking at a different way because still the economy is growing, everything is going good, but stocks go down. How come that there is such an imbalance globally? Everything on a global scale is intercorrelated. If something goes bad in China, America will suffer too. Europe will suffer too. That's inevitable in today's world. Let's see a bit deeper. So the Federal Reserve issued its statement and they say that the economy has continued to strengthen, the labor market has continued to strengthen, everything has been raising at a strong rate, job gains have been strong, fixed investment has grown strongly. So everything is strong. This means that probably they will hike rates as always, so they have the power to hike rates as the economy is very strong, even with slowly raising rates. That's their policy, so we can expect another hike in September and then perhaps another hike in December. The GDP, very, very good, best in almost 4 years this quarter. Unemployment, extremely good, below 4%. Fixed investment, still very positive, and consumer spending extremely growing. Everybody is very, very confident. However, we have seen Shanghai. If we switch to Europe, things aren't that good in Europe, but sentiment is still strong. Let's see what's going on in Europe. This is very interesting. Look, this is the correlation between the European stock market and the US stock market. The blue line is the S&P 500, and you can see how stocks were almost perfectly correlated up till 2009-2010, and then they strongly diverged. European stocks are up, 25% on this chart, while the S&P 500 is up more than 120%. Huge divergence. And you can see the correlation here. It was very high up till 0.8. One is perfect correlation. And now we are below 0.4. So extremely uncorrelated. So that's another sign how the US market keeps pushing forward while others are not doing that good. Eurozone GDP also came below expected, so declining GDP growth, as we can see here, over the last two quarters. Per country, the troubled countries are seeing slower growth. Spain is growing slower, Italy is growing extremely slow, again 0.15%, so that's very, very slow, not 1.5%, 0.15%. Which means that the troubled countries might lead to more trouble. However, consumer confidence, and consumers always base what they're doing on the past, on the availability of credit, on cheap money, is still very, very high and has never been so high in the past decades. So the message here is that those balances, those correlations that are not, will somehow rebalance themselves in the long term. Similarly to what Apple was, cheap in the beginning, now it's getting more and more expensive. The good will become more expensive, the bad will become cheap. That's how it goes in the market. So as an investor, you have to just see, okay, what's undervalued, buy it for a nice yield, as Apple had a great yield 2 years ago, and then wait for the market to recognize that quality and that yield. It might take time for you to find such stocks, but just give it time and you start building a long-term portfolio over time. You find here somewhere, you find there somewhere, and then you have a great portfolio. That's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing with my model portfolio and my stock market research platform. So check it out in the link in the description below if you're interested for more. I want to finish with something very, very nice. I found this chart that shows the largest company by market capitalization in each year. For the past, 7 years, it has been, of course, Apple that has hit now $1 trillion, but before that, it was for a slow time, PetroChina. It did even hit $1 trillion in 2000, 7 or 8, I think. Then Exxon with higher oil prices was the largest company. Before that, General Electric, and then they started doing lots of buybacks, and now we all know what happened to them. Microsoft in the bubble was the biggest company, General Electric before that again, and then again Exxon in the 1990s, early 1990s. So all those things can change. A few years, someone is up, then someone is down, and who knows who will be the next largest company in the world. That's one you want to be invested in. Investing in the biggest, it's always a little bit risky. Thank you for watching, looking forward to your comments about this divergence in global markets, Shanghai down, S&P 500 up, Europe economic, weak data as always from Europe, even if all the money printing. So what do you think will go on in the next 5-10 years? How will this balance out? I'll see you in the next video.